There's the cloud in here this morning.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah.
Thank the Lord.
I'm drunk with the Spirit this morning. I like it. It feels good.
Amen.
I needed it really, really bad. Just like you needed really, really bad.
That's right.
Bible says, merry heart doeth good like medicine. I was taught at a young age to yield to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
When I was young, I grew up at Belmont Believers Church in Fresno. Pastor Tom Tiemens. We had children's pastors. I don't even remember who they were right now, but that was good, Clarence.
Hallelujah.
Hey, Tammy. that word in tongues that you had earlier during praise and worship. Go ahead. Go ahead. We've stepped into a new season. The hospital is open. This is a hospital. And the sick will be healed. The sick will be tended to. For many have come into this place over the years and you've been sick. But you've been starting to mend. God's been mending you with His Word. God's been mending you with His Spirit. God's been touching you. You've been learning. You've been getting revelation. You've been getting wisdom. You've been getting knowledge. And that revelation and that wisdom and that knowledge that God has been speaking to you and the Holy Ghost has been delivering you to is bringing you to a wholeness in the body of Christ. Not only in the body of Christ, but in your particular calling, in your particular calling in the body of Christ. God's bringing you. So the hospital has opened. It's a new season. Folks will come in. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready to lay hands? Are you ready to bless with your mouth? Are you ready to speak the life of God? Are you ready to help move with the Lord in the things of the Lord to bring the sick here to be healed, says the Spirit of God. So we stepped into a new season. Any of you will begin to receive healing. Things that have dogged you and bugged you and hindered you for the last several years, maybe some decades, and will begin to leave your life.
Thank you, Lord.
The hospital is open. Many will be free. This will be a church known for healing victory.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, we receive healing right now.
Thank you,
we receive healing, spirit, soul, and body right now. We receive healing in our minds. We receive healing in our bodies. We declare healing. Your word says if we'll declare it, it'll be established. And Lord, we put our believing with our declaring.
Receive it, Lord. Thank you,
Father.
Thank you, Father.
The enemy has come to bring pressure to bear. But I have come, says the Lord, to deliver you from care. If you'll just cast your cares and leave it with me, then you'll go from a place of knowing about and entering into actually being free.
Yeah.
For my Spirit is here, and He's working every day to bring you into that place where you can escape from the enemy and even run away. But don't turn around and go back to that place. For I'm welcoming you through my word into the throne of grace. Learn to live in my place. Learn to abide in me. Learn to walk in the truth that is in your spirit, and you'll stay free. For it's my desire, says the Lord, to not only turn you loose, but it's my desire, says the Lord, to take you to a higher place so that you can move and release the grace. Blessing the people that are all around, who'll hear from your mouth that joyful sound. And as they receive it, they'll be set free, because you're not living in you, you're abiding in me.
Yes. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. The truth that's in us. The truth that's in us delivers us.
Thank you, Lord.
The word of the Lord that's in us delivers us. Delivers us.
Yes.
Thank you for that, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Ooh, hallelujah. Turn over to Ephesians chapter 1. Stay locked in. Stay hooked into the Spirit. We're just riding a wave right now. Let's just stay on that wave of what the Lord wants to do. You know, as I was saying before, I was raised to yield to the Holy Spirit and to listen to the Holy Spirit. And, you know, the Western Church has been a good thing. It's been a good thing to a lot of people. A lot of people have gone on home already, died, and went to heaven because of the church here. We're in the Western Church, and it's been good with us. But a lot of the Western Church throws out the moving of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit. Things that will bring us life and things that will help us during, you know, test trials, things that will help us just on our daily lives, no matter what's going on in our lives, whatever. We can always hold true to the Word of the Lord and to what the Word of God says. Amen? Amen. And, you know, I was taught at a young age to yield to the Holy Spirit. I remember times as a child just, you know, where the Lord would come in to our children's church services and just the presence of God, and we'd start weeping and crying. And I remember as a little kid not even understanding why I'm crying or why I'm weeping. Yeah. I didn't even know. I was just going along with what was going on in the meeting there as a child. And as a young boy, you know, I saw a lot of stuff that some adults right now hasn't even seen yet. Yeah. You know, with healings and different manifestations of the Spirit, different things. You know, when I was a child, I don't remember seeing this, but I remember hearing about this. Our pastor, Pastor Shogia back then, said that right in front of everybody, she danced right off the stage in midair and came back onto the stage. Yeah. Wow. Stuff like that. Well, I don't believe that. Well, the Bible talks about wonders.
Yes, amen.
Because when you see something like that, you're going, I wonder how the heck that happened. And we don't make wonders happen. We don't make signs happen. We don't make those things take place. We're just supposed to believe.
That's right. That's a good word.
Jesus says, believe in miracles, signs, and wonders.
Yeah.
And then he goes on further to say that if you'll believe, you'll do the works that I did.
Yeah.
And even more. You know, as you read the Word, that a lot of times that Jesus was seemed like whenever he was really able to do something for somebody, it was usually because the other person believed.
Amen.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So I want to say this to you today. Don't get discouraged if you pray for somebody and they don't get healed. Because I've prayed for a lot of people that have died. Don't let it discourage you. I pray for a lot of people that have gone on. I pray for a lot of people that haven't gotten healed. But I pray for a lot of people that have gotten healed. Why did I say that? I don't know, but don't be discouraged. We are to flow in miracles, signs, and wonders. We are to be a sign to some people, we are to be a wonder to some people, and we are to be a miracle to some people. We are. And you just go with it. You know, you go with it every day. It's a good thing to wake up every morning and just say, man, Lord, today's awesome. I wonder how you're going to use me today for somebody. Or I wonder how you're going to use me for me.
Yeah. God is so good.
He's good. He loves us.
Yes. Yes.
He loves you so much. I mean, there's no one like you in his eyes. And he loves you. Amen?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And so, I learned how to... And I know a lot of us in here understand this and stuff. And the Holy Spirit isn't weird, or God isn't weird, or, you know, some of the things that we see, we might think, wow. I mean, there's even some things I see, I kind of go, wow, man, that's pretty wild. But you see the demonstration of God, you see something happening in their life that totally changed their life. I remember hearing a story that Brother Joe Jordan shared several times that there was a lady in his meeting, and he prayed for her, and she ended up, God just touching her and helping her and healing her, and she ended up singing, I'm a little teapot short and stout. Here's my handle, and here's my spout. And she sung that song over and over and over again in the front of the church, in front of everybody. Now, the religious mind would be like, what in the world? But it wouldn't be nothing for someone to be at a bar that's drunk and singing a bunch of stuff that they've never sang before.
Yeah, right.
But if you're at church,
come on, kick that religion out.
Come on, guys. Listen, I'm just going to be honest with you. I've been asking the Lord, God, I want you just to get me so drunk.
Amen. Yes.
I want to laugh. I begin to laugh. I don't even feel like laughing. I'll just start laughing at the house. Shane, what's the matter? They'll turn up. What's the matter, Dad? Nothing. I just got to laugh right now because fear is trying to attack me.
Right.
What's the matter? Nothing. I just got to laugh because the devil's lying in me. Live in fear, live in panic, live in anxiety, live in it. But sometimes, what did Mom say? Sometimes you got to labor into rest.
Yes.
You don't feel like it, but sometimes you got to force yourself. Guys, we don't run from the devil. He runs from us. That's how special he is. I'm learning this more and more. I've known this. Listen, guys, there's a difference between knowing something, head knowledge, and really acting upon it. It's two different things. A lot of y'all know the word really, really well. There's a difference between knowing it and acting on it, though. There's a difference between knowing it and just kind of, okay, I know it, but there's a difference when you know it and then you pull it out like a sword.
Yes!
And you say, what, devil? And however you have to whack him, if that's laughing, then you laugh.
Amen.
If that's telling him to shut up in the name of, you can't stand the name of Jesus, just use the name of Jesus, he'll leave you alone. The Bible says resist the devil, he'll flee from you. Resist him. You tell him no, no. You know, we dominate him, he doesn't dominate us. God's given us dominion and authority over him. He didn't give it to the devil. He gave it to us to have dominion over him. That's why he says he's under our feet, guys.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Come on.
Amen. And so, we should hunger for spiritual gifts. We should hunger for the things of God. We should hunger. And I know we hunger. I know we do. But let me tell you something. I think that a lot of times in our minds, we make it so difficult to receive from God what He wants to give us. We've all done that. We all do that. And most of the time, it's really, really simple if we'll just do what the Word says. And even if we've got to do it 100 times a day. Until it just builds us so strong on the inside that we have victory in that area, then we got to do whatever it takes.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
That's the word. We got to do the word. We're word people. Amen. Now listen over here in Ephesians chapter 1. Look at verse 15. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15. This is a letter that Paul. Excuse me. This is a letter that Paul is writing to the church of Ephesus. And he says here in verse 15, he says, therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. You hear that? The Father of glory. Amen. God's so full of glory. What is glory? It's the manifestation of His power. That's the glory.
Amen.
God is so full of glory, so much glory. There's times like this morning, His heavy glory presence, the glory cloud, whatever you want to call it. Some of you might have seen it. Some of you might have felt it. Some of you might have just known that it's here because you feel the awesome presence of God. Amen. You felt that or saw that or understood that it was here this morning and it's still here.
Yes.
He's the Father of glory. He gets all the glory. He gives the glory.
Yes.
He gets it and He gives it. Amen.
Yes.
So it says, 18, verse 18, in the eyes of your understanding, what is the hope of His calling? What are the riches that you may know what the hope of His calling, and what are the riches of His glory, of His inheritance in the saints? And what is the exceeding greatness of His power toward us who what? Believe. According to the working of His mighty power. Verse 20. Which He worked in Christ when He raised Him from the dead and seated Him at His right hand in heavenly places. So we can see that. You picture that in your mind. You see Father God blowing the power, putting the power on His Son, Jesus Christ. You see his son being raised from the dead, and then picture in your mind Christ going up before the Father in heavenly places, seated at the right hand of Father God. See Jesus right now in your spirit or in your mind, however you got to do it. See Jesus sitting at the right hand of the Father. Now you got to listen to what I'm going to talk about today, because I want you to get a hold of this. You should leave this place this morning with some fresh revelation concerning some things in your life.
Amen.
No matter where you're at spiritually, if you're in kindergarten, 5th grade, 12th grade, doesn't matter. Where you're at spiritually, you should walk out of here with some kind of fresh revelation from the Spirit of God this morning, to where when you leave this place, you have an understanding about some things this morning.
Amen.
That's what I pray for you guys today.
Amen.
And for myself.
Thank you, Lord.
So we're going somewhere today. Now just listen to this, because this is something that we need to get a hold of. And even if we have a hold of it, we need to continue in it, praise God. So Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father in heavenly places. Verse 21. Far above. Far above. All principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. See Jesus. Seated at the right hand of the Father. In heavenly places. And it says, far above. Now I want to get ahead of myself today, but I can't get ahead of myself today. Because I can feel some of your minds are turning in here, and you want to go somewhere, and I want to go there too. So I know you understand what I'm saying. But he's far. Why don't you just go ahead and just turn that speaker off? Or is this? Or what?
It might be.
Because that's annoying. I don't want to be annoying.
We don't like you when you're annoying.
Amen.
Yeah.
Todd Bentley came out of here. What's going on here? No.
Turn it off.
Okay, so here we go. We see Jesus, and I love it because there in 21 it says, far above all principality. Okay, verse 22. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to who? The church. Say he gave things
to the church.
To us. Amen. Okay. So, verse 23, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all and all. See, Jesus has to exercise his authority and exercise what he wants to do, not through him, but through who?
Us.
Jesus has already done what he's going to do. He gave his life. He went to the cross. He didn't chew gum and pop bubbles in church. But he went... Oh, sorry. I ain't looking at who did it. I don't even know who did it. I just heard it over there. So you've been warned. Praise God. I'm homeless. Anyways, all right, so... I love whoever did that. I don't even know who did that. Make sure you come up and give me a hug after church so you know that I love you. Amen. So, I love whoever did that over there. Popping the devil's bubble. There you go. See, Dad always turns something, you know. Amen. I don't think I've ever read that scripture. But anyways. So, Jesus has done what he's going to do. And the thing he continues to do for sure is to love people and to love his body. Amen. But he's given us authority on this earth to exercise what he's done for people, to exercise it through us to do what we need to do, what he wants to do on this earth. He uses you guys. He uses us. Amen? And you notice that Jesus isn't seated here on earth below us. It says he's seated far above. Far above. Way above. anything the enemy is trying to do, wants to do, what he thinks he's going to do, he's far above.
It's good.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Word.
The enemy's like a bug to him. Yeah. You see that spider run across your floor in your kitchen? What do you do to that sucker? Oh, you just head into the grocery store, just let it go. To the fridge. No. Kill that sucker, man. You don't want those things breeding in your house. That's what the enemy is to God. That's what the enemy should be to us. He's cut off. Now, the Bible calls the devil, you know, the father of this world. The prince of power of the air. He can manipulate things here on earth. He can manipulate people. He can manipulate 50 years of being a Christian kind of person. If they allow him to. He's a deceiver. He's a liar. He's looking. Who can I devour, man? Who can I curse? Who can I give cancer? Who can I, you know, he looks at all this stuff. Which is another thing that brought something back to me right here when I was saying that. We read over there in verse 21, it says that far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. That word there, name, it says here that he's given us power, might, and dominion and every name that is named. Any kind of thing that's named, you have authority over. What did God tell Adam in the garden? Name that animal and you have authority over it. Well, Mike Purcell, you have leukemia. Sounds like a name, don't it?
Yes.
Leukemia has a name? Guess what? I had authority over that name.
Amen.
Oh, well, you're just crazy. That's okay. I'm not sick anymore. You can come to the Lord with me in July, and you can look at my blood, and you can listen to what he says, and we can walk out of the praise of the Lord together. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Healed miraculously by the power of the living God. Amen. A lot of you have been healed too, so you know.
Yep.
Every name. Whatever it is the enemy's trying to do to you, it has a name.
Yes.
If it's fear, it has a name.
Come on.
If it's oppression, it has a name. It's torment. It has a name. He's seated you far above. He's given you dominion over that name. You use your authority. Well, I don't know that much of the Bible. You don't have to know that much of the Bible. You tell the devil, you just have to know the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Know the Bible. Read the Bible. Study the Bible. Get the Bible in you. Get the Word of the Lord in you. That's huge. We need that. Growing that every day. You should. But you have authority over that name. Okay, so some of you, I wanted to share that with you because, you know, you've been letting the devil lie to you about certain things. You take authority over that. If you've been diagnosed with some kind of disease or sickness or some kind of deal, you call it by name and you tell it to get out of your life in the name of Jesus. And if you have to do it 365 times in 1 year, every day, then you do it until it leaves. And it will, because the Bible says you have what you say. The Bible says that death and life from the power of the tongue, Proverbs 18, verse 21. It says that you control who you are, where you are, what you do with your mouth.
Yeah.
And what you have.
Yes, sir.
It's true. I have literally felt and known beyond a shadow of a doubt at times that the Lord told me that this person will be healed if you'll lay hands on them.
Yeah.
I've laid hands on them, and you know what? They didn't get healed. And I would go and I'd be like, what? What? What's going on, God? You said they'd be healed if I laid my hands on. And you know what he said? They didn't believe. They didn't believe. They didn't take it. That goes for all of us. What do we believe? Is our thinking right? Are we lined up with the Word? You know, yesterday, here's a good tip. And Mom gave this tip to me, so I give her all the credit. I've heard her say this several times over the years. When the devil gives you a thought about something, and you know it's the enemy because usually there's no peace.
Yeah.
And it's usually some kind of death or destruction or some kind of deal that isn't love. It brings fear, basically.
Yeah.
Next time that happens to you, I want you to do this. Try to remember this. Immediately.
Yeah.
Immediately say, well, cast it down. That's true, Sister Liz. That's exactly right. But immediately say, Father God, what do you say about that?
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
He'll answer you immediately.
Yeah.
I promise.
Yes.
I've done that. Last night, a thought came to me, and immediately I said, Father God, what do you say about that? And he said, I've already said to you what I'm going to say about that.
Oh, yes.
That's what he said to me. And I know what he was talking about. In other words, I've already said it. Don't worry about it. I've already said to you what I'm going to say. What does that mean to me? That means that I need to grab a hold of what he said. If I need to go back and start digging and finding out what he said, then I need to go. But I knew exactly what he was talking about. So I walked over to my little folder, and I pulled out the piece of paper that I knew he was talking about, and I began to look at that thing, and I said, Father, you said this, you said this, you said this, you said this. And you know what? Fear left, anxiety left, all that junk left. Immediately, because why? The word of God destroys the yoke of bondage. The anointing destroys the yoke of bondage. The word, the praise, the power of God, the presence of God, the glory of God. And you know what? I just want to tell you something. I didn't feel drunk. I didn't feel his presence. I didn't feel tingly. I didn't feel any of that stuff. I just heard what he said, and I acted on it, and I began to say what he said over again out of my mouth.
Yeah.
And then the enemy's defeated.
Yeah.
So it's not, we got to stop making this hard. We got to just believe what the word says and act on it and speak it. And it's your responsibility, not pastor's, not mine, to get an understanding of the word. We teach the word, we share the word, but you've got to get in there and dig and get a revelation of that.
Yeah.
Amen? Amen. You got to exercise the word. I mean, that would be awesome if like, I could call Tammy and be like, hey, you know, I put on a few pounds, and would you mind going jogging for me today? And I'll lose some weight today, and he'll go work out hard. Slip me in the gun, I'm going to drink water, and we'll be good. That would be nice, wouldn't it? It'd be easy. But see, a lot of people go to church, and that's what they expect the pastors to be for them, or the leadership to be for them. Doesn't work that way. Even growing up in a pastor's home, there was a certain time I was under my mom and dad's authority and all that kind of stuff. They were able to pray for me, but there came an age where I came to an age where now I've got to start using my faith and authority. They can pray. You know, we can pray for each other. We can speak blessing over each other. We should. It's good. It's the best thing we can do for each other. We can sharpen each other, love on each other, believe with each other. But when it comes down to it, we have got to, when we're laying in our bed at night and everyone's asleep and we're quiet and the enemy's coming after us, what are we going to do? I would prefer don't call me at 2 in the morning. That'd be great. Deal with it yourself. Get before the Lord. That sounds harsh, but I mean that funny in a fun way. Don't want to offend anybody, but I mean that in a fun way. But there comes a time where we've got to get with God by ourselves. And we've got to take care of business. Guys, you got to know that the Father loves you. And he's got everything that you need to sustain you and bless you and keep you for the rest of your life. Not only on this earth, but for eternity, guys. We know that about eternity. But listen, we've got to get it down here as well. We've got to know that the kingdom of God is at hand. We've got to know that his kingdom is coming down on earth, that we can have heaven on earth, that we can walk in kingdom authority like Jesus did when he was here. We can now. Now, many folks will take that and twist it and say, well, he's calling himself Christ, or they're calling himself Jesus. That's not what I'm saying. Jesus gave us, the Father God gave us authority. When Jesus died and left this earth, he says, I'm not leaving you orphans. I'm sending the Holy Spirit. He's going to be your comforter, your counselor. And guess what? You're going to be able to get baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. I'm going to tell you, the reason why seasons are changing and things are happening in this community right here, Madera, California, the reason why I'm anticipating, it's like that surfer waiting for that wave coming in, the perfect one. I'm sitting on the surfboard right now, and I'm doing what God's wanting me to do. I'm preparing myself, and that wave's building, and I can see it, and I'm anticipating it. And a lot of you are anticipating it, and I'm telling you right now, we've gone into another season in this city. A portal of heaven has been opened over Madera, California. I've seen it. It's been opened, and I'm telling you right now that we are getting ready to usher in the church, the body of Christ, you are getting ready to usher in the biggest movement that Madera, California has ever seen. It's coming. It's on its way. We're in the start of it right now. Things are going to start springing forth by the glory of God. Because the church has been praying. I can't speak about any other ministry in town. I don't know. But this ministry, for years, we have been praying. And praying, corporate prayer. Praying, declaring, giving birth, travailing, speaking. We've been praying and praying and praying and praying and praying. And that has prepared that portal of heaven to open over this city, an unlikely city in people's minds. I hear more people talk bad stuff about Madera than I do good stuff about Madera. And I don't like it. This is my promised land. This is where I have milk and honey, glory. This is where I have all the cattle on the hills. This is where I have all my blessings. This is my Goshen glory. And guess what? I rule and reign in Madera, California. And so do you. Oh, you're just a cocky young man. No, I'm just confident in the word. It says we're kings and priests unto our God. We have authority. We live in a town where in the city hall and in the county hall, they have in God we trust on the wall. That right there just set a spark to me, man. That just even more assured it that glory is getting to invade this city. Hallelujah. You know, 2 weeks ago, there was a prophetic word that was given. I gave a prophetic word and I saw this vision and I explained it and I began to prophesy about what I saw. I saw God open up a window or like a portal out of heaven. And when I saw him do that, it was like I saw his hand come down and open this portal up. All portal is, you know, you hear that word, it's just a window. And I saw God open this thing up. I saw his hand come down, open it up. And then I saw him kind of look down upon us. And when he did, I saw us turn into eagles. And I saw us start to come up and start to, and the word was about soaring. On the wind of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So when I saw that, I didn't look at that vision that I saw. I didn't see that as a portal of heaven. That's not how I saw it at first. That revelation came to me a few days after that. And I come across this prophetic word on the Elijah list by a man by the name of David Herzog that gave a prophetic word about portals, and God was showing him there's several cities in America that portals were getting ready to, that portals had opened or getting ready to open over. So I read this word. It's a lengthy word. I read this word, and I'm going, oh, I can't wait to get to the cities. I wonder if Madera's on there.
Praise God.
And I got to the cities, and he named off several, and Madera wasn't there. And when I got there reading the cities, I went, oh, man. And God said, that's what I showed you 2 Sundays
ago.
Yes,
we already
got it. It's already open.
Woo!
Okay, so why would God do that? Well, God would open a portal over something because he wants to give the kingdom into that area.
Yes.
And he wants his body to get a hold of that. You can reject what I just said right now, or you can receive what I just said right now. It's up to you, totally up to you. But there's an opportunity right now. Listen, guys, I don't know about you, but there's an opportunity right now for you to speak the oracles of God everywhere you go. And you won't even recognize it sometimes that you're doing it. But it'll be for that specific person that you're talking to, guys. There were things I was saying to this guy yesterday that I could just see it on his face that God was just touching me. I didn't even go over to preach this guy. I was just going over just to... It was my neighbor, and I was just chit-chatting with him, and he was having a yard sale, and I was over there just talking to him, you know, and I said, hey, man, can I throw some stuff over here, too? He's like, yeah, so I threw some stuff over there. But I was just over there hanging out with him, man. He wanted, you know, just the guy thing. He wanted to show me his backyard. He's remodeling and blah, blah, blah. You know, he's blowing cigarettes and all this stuff. You know, we're just talking. I wasn't blowing cigarettes. He was. But we're just talking. I got delivered from that a long time ago. But I was just talking to him, and he's talking to me. And all of a sudden, he just started unloading on me.
Yeah.
Everything that's gone on in his life from the time he was a boy to now, and just all this stuff this dude has gone through, and it was, he's only 26 years old, and I was amazed at the stuff that went on in his life already.
A lot of peace,
yeah. It was almost unbelievable, really. But he was sincere as could be. And I said, well, you know what? And I just began to talk and just love on him. And I could see him sitting there, and he didn't say a word for about 10 minutes. He just sat there and just stared at me. And I'm standing there, and I'm just, in my mind, I'm going, okay, Lord, you know, this is an opportunity here, just whatever you want to say. And I'm just talking to him and loving on him. And there is such an opportunity right now for that for us.
Yeah.
See, when God opens something,
right,
we don't have to, oh, I'm going to make this happen.
Come on. No,
it's, you walk right into it.
Right.
When it's 105 in Madera outside, I never have to make myself go get in the pool. I just fall into the pool. It's very simple, very easy. I don't care if I have all my clothes. It doesn't matter. It feels good. It's just easy. But we don't have to make us. It's so easy right now. Just every day walk into an opportunity. There's opportunities every day to minister. Now, okay, so the fullness of him. Now look at verse 1 in chapter 2. And you, listen, and you guys, and us, and me, and you, he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. Talking about the devil. Verse 3. Among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others. Now listen, verse 4, this is so awesome. But God, everyone say, but God. Who is rich in mercy, hallelujah.
Yes.
Who is rich in mercy. Say, God,
God
is rich
in
mercy
for me.
Who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us even when we were dead in trespasses. Now listen, God made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. Now listen to verse 6. And raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You remember earlier we read about that? I had you get that picture in your mind or your spirit about seeing God bringing Jesus up to the heavens, praise God, and sitting him down at the Father's right hand. We saw that picture, right? Well, what does it say right there? And I know a lot of us know this, but some of us don't know this. And even if you do know this, I've known this all my life. And I'm just now starting to get a hold of the gold nuggets that are in this for me. You got to see yourself. It's not your imagination. It's not weird. It's the truth. We just read it. You got to see yourself in Christ. It, God said that he raised up Christ, and he also raised us up. He said he seated Jesus next to his right hand, and then the Bible says that we're in Christ, and Christ is in us.
Yes.
Guys, we rule and reign on this earth. The devil will tell us how to act or what to do or what's going to happen. We tell him how to act, what he's going to do, and what's going to happen, guys. That's the authority. And I know every day you don't feel like it. I get it. I know every day the enemy lies to you and he wants to bring you back instead of you going forward. I understand that. But sometimes you just got to get flat ticked off.
Right.
You tell him, and you move on.
Yeah.
You know, some of you, you know, when you talk told your kids to do something, you want them to do it right away. And what's wild is they didn't. You made it happen one way or another. If that was giving them a brain adjustment, then you did it. Or however you did it, they got it done. That's the same thing with the devil. You tell him. And if you say, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus, you shut your mouth. The Bible says, resist the devil and you have to flee from me. So you can flee from me now in the name of Jesus. And if you do that, and then he pops right back off again and says, blah, 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 blah to you, then you say it again.
Yeah,
that's right.
You do it again.
That's right.
I had a person a while back tell me, you know, rebuking the devil just doesn't work. I really didn't know what to say. There's just sometimes I can't answer questions like that because I get irritated about stuff like that. Because I know so, yes, I know so much of that. It's hard. I just said, well, almost like they wanted to argue with me about it. You know how you just get that sometimes, that argument? I just can't do that no more. Just can't do that kind of stuff anymore. I never really wanted to before, really. But we have to rebuke that. We have to. Because he doesn't come in and be like, hey, you know, do you mind if I hang out? He doesn't do that. He comes in fast, furious, and hard. And sometimes the way he comes into your life, you got to come into his life. Come over to my house and try to break in and see what happens. Whether or no, you're not. If you're coming to do harm to my family, I'm going to harm you. You would do the same to me. That's how you got to look at the enemy, guys.
Amen.
He'll try to sell you a lot of goods, man. He'll try to sell you all kinds of stuff. He'll try to get you thinking one direction. And just bring torment and misery and harm. He's a liar.
Yep.
He's a liar. You've got to see yourself. Now, these are good scriptures. Some of you need to just eat these the whole week.
Right.
Just eat them. Meditate on them. Chew on them.
Amen.
See yourself in Christ. See Christ in you. And see yourself seated together in heavenly places with him.
Amen.
And see yourself far above all principalities and powers of darkness. And see yourself above every name that is named.
Yes.
He's given you authority over every name, everything that is named. He's given you authority.
Yes.
Now you'll know by the Spirit of God if you're using your authority correctly or not. Some preachers use the authority they have and they twist it and they use it to gain money. They're using it wrong. That's not right. That's wrong. You know, sometimes we got to watch out that we don't try to manipulate certain situations and certain things because it turns into witchcraft. We shouldn't try to manipulate anything. We either trust God that he's going to take care of us or he's not. That's it, man. We either trust God that he's going to take care of our kids or he's not, guys.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
God's voice is loud enough to speak to our children. God's voice is loud enough. His directions, his ways, his thoughts, everything he has is big enough and good enough and brilliant enough to take care of your needs, your situation. It really is.
Amen.
He really is. So, it says here in verse 6, and raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come, verse 7, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace, or you could say favor, it's another word for grace, favor, of grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace, or by favor, you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, It is the gift of God. Not of works, lest anyone should boast. Now listen to verse 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Grace, or favor, guys, empowers us to do what God has called us to do, guys. Favor from God pushes you into a realm, into something that he has called you to do. It's because of his grace that you're able to minister. It's because of his grace that you're able to love. It's because of his grace that you're able to get an understanding of the word of the Lord for your life.
Yes. Amen.
It's by grace that he gives me word of knowledges all the time.
Amen.
It's by his grace. It's because of his favor on other people. Because we read earlier that Jesus exercises his authority through the body of Christ, through his body, through his bride, through us. So if God needs to give something to us, he'll say something to us, or he'll give something to us, because usually it's for others. He blesses us, he takes care of us, all that, we understand that. But a lot of times, whoo, man, he'll give us things to give out to others because they need something.
Amen.
See, what I want you to get a hold of today is know. You got to know this. You got to get an understanding of this. And if you have to read this over and over again, read it over and over again. I recommend, honestly, that you either get on YouTube or you can order the book on Amazon or even through the ministry there. But a book that Kenneth E. Hagin wrote called The Authority of the Believer.
Amen.
Yes. Read it.
Amen.
Yeah, that will be the best book you've ever read in your life, I promise you.
Amen.
It is so simple.
Yes.
It's what we're talking about today, really, to be honest with you. These scriptures are right all over the place. But understanding who you are in Christ and who Christ is in you. And when the devil comes, it'll be like that fly in that mosquito, man. You'll just whack it with the word.
Yeah.
And sometimes you gotta labor to get into that rest. Sometimes, guys, I understand it's not easy all the time. But listen, we fight the good fight of faith. We stay strong in the faith. We stand strong. We believe the word.
Yeah.
And you know what's huge concerning this is you gotta watch what you say, man.
Yes.
What are you saying about your life? About yourself? What are you saying?
Amen.
Well, the flu's going around. We're probably gonna get it eventually. It'll catch up to us. It's gonna catch up to you if you say that. I know a lady, and none of you know her, so don't worry about it. I've known her probably about 22 years, and I've heard her say this probably about, I don't know, a dozen times since I've known her. I'm not going to go out. One of these days, I'm probably going to end up getting mugged going to the store over there. One of these days, it's probably going to happen. People out there these days are just crazy. And I heard her say it probably a dozen times. And you know what? One day she got mugged. They stole her purse. And she couldn't understand why it would happen to her. It's the honest to God truth, guys.
Amen. Yeah.
Well, I just don't believe that. Well, guys, we need to line up what we're thinking and what we're saying with the word of the Lord. I know a lot of us in here are really mature, and you understand what I'm talking about today. You know that you'll have what you say, because we've all experienced that, good or bad. We all have, guys. All of us. But there's times where I'll mouth off or say something, and the Holy Spirit will just arrest me. Man. Wait a minute, what are you saying, Mike? That's stupid. Don't say stuff like that. And I'll repent. We all do that, I know that. But what are we saying about ourselves? How do we see ourselves? And I understand everybody's different, and we've gone through things. All of us have had different life experiences and just You know, just we do, but guys, listen, I'll tell you, the Lord will bring healing in your life, guys. The Lord will heal you of whatever that trauma is, whatever that thing is in your life that's taking place over your course of time here. God will heal you. I'm 42 years old, and there's things that have been that's happened in my life, things that I've done, maybe things that maybe happened to me that I wasn't even aware of or didn't know was going on, to where it's finally coming to a head in my life, and I'm getting an understanding of how I let the Lord heal me of that.
Yeah.
We're all there, guys. Come on.
Yeah.
And what does the Lord want to do that? Well, He wants us free.
Yeah.
He doesn't want anything to hold us back.
Right.
From having peace, from having joy, from having love, from having the ministry or the future that He's blessed us with, leaving the heritage to our family that He's called us to leave. He doesn't want that hindered. He wants that to be in fullness. As we're on this earth, but before we leave this earth, He wants us delivered and set free in Him. Not so we can make it to heaven. That has nothing to do with it. It's while we're here on earth. We're going to heaven. You're born again. You're a child of God. You're there, man. Just consider yourself there.
Yeah.
You don't have to strive to make it. Just pray and obey and obey the Lord.
Right.
But while we're here, I want the love, the power, the presence, the glory of the Lord, the presence of God. I want the wisdom, the knowledge, the revelation. I want everything He has for my life.
Yeah.
Not only just for me so I can grow, but so I can help others.
Yeah.
That should be our mentality.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Your anointing that God's giving you is for others anyhow. It ain't for you. We just obey God. He blesses us. Takes care of us. We don't have to worry about that. But I want you to see yourself. See yourself sitting there with Jesus in heavenly places. See yourself having authority over principalities, power, darkness. See yourself having authority, because guys, it's not just a hope, it's the reality if you'll believe the word of the Lord.
Yeah.
It's in the Bible. We read it. I didn't read any word scriptures today. Everything I read out of there was in the word of the Lord.
Yeah.
You can have it, or you can get rid of it. Whatever you want. I want to have it.
Yeah, man.
And we have authority.
Yeah.
We've got to see ourselves in Christ. In Christ. Pray that people will see Christ in you.
Yeah.
It's one of my favorite, that's one of my biggest prayers. I pray a lot. Lord, I just want people to see Jesus in me.
Yes.
Yeah.
I don't really care if they know who I am or whatever. I just want them to see Jesus in me.
Yeah.
And you know what? A lot of you guys, believe it or not, man, you know, and sometimes it's hard for me to believe sometimes too, but that's what people see. That's why they're attracted to you. That's why they want you to pray for them. That's why they want, all of a sudden, you start learning about this person's life and you don't even know the person, you know? Because they see something in you and on you. And it's a peace thing. It's a love thing. They see it. So they're drawing off who's in you.
Yeah.
And then you, as they draw, you let them have, man. You give it to them. You feed them. Could be a year process with someone. It could be a 5-minute thing with someone. And they get born again right there. I don't know. But you just allow the Lord to use you. But you got to see yourself in Christ. The more and more I go, I just try to keep my eyes off the way the world's going.
Amen.
I know we got to understand some things, and we got to know what's going on in some areas. I get that. But I want to know more about what the Lord's doing in the kingdom.
Yes.
And really what's going on here, because that's where I live.
Amen.
That's where we're going to live. Let's get kind of acclimated to it now. You know what I mean?
Yes.
And this morning, if you were... Even if you're oppressing it or not, this morning the kingdom of heaven was in this place this morning. There's angels here right now. Why? Because we're exalting the name of Jesus. That's what they do. They're with us. Jesus Himself is in this building. I'm sure of it.
Absolutely.
Why not? We love Him. He's welcoming. The Father's love is in here this morning. The Father's peace is in here this morning. His holy presence is here. And what's awesome is we're the temple of the Holy Ghost. Not this building with these walls and brick and all this stuff. We are the temple of the Holy Ghost. We carry the Holy Ghost. Everywhere we go. We are the church. We're at church, but we are the church.
Exactly.
You can have church anywhere.
Hallelujah. That is true.
Amen. We are seated far above. Far above. What, devil?
Amen.
Oh, yeah, you're under my feet. I forgot. Gives us authority to trample on scorpions and snakes and every evil thing. Not literal scorpions and snakes, but he's using that reference as demons.
Yes. Amen.
And the devil. That's what that means. You have it. How much of it do you want to live in? That's the question. How much do you want to grow in that authority? How much do you want to grow in knowing who you are in Christ? That's up to you. Better be Jesus calling. Amen? Or Jesus testing, one or the other. Amen? I love you guys. You guys are awesome, man. I feel love every time I come here, you know? Let me close this out today with just a short prophetic word here that I brought. I wanted to read this morning. I didn't know if I was going to get to it, but I felt like the Lord wants me to do it. Talking about the wind. Talking about soaring like eagles, and a little quick snippet I gave about that prophetic word the Lord gave me a couple Sundays ago about us being lifted up like eagles and just soaring on the wind of the Holy Spirit and allowing Him to do something. Well, here's a word that was given here last week by a lady by the name of Jennifer LeClaire. And it says here, it says, I was in prayer seeking the Lord. Now listen to this. I was in prayer seeking the Lord about the season we're entering into. And He said something very distinct. Ride the wind.
Yeah.
I've learned we need to discern what the Holy Spirit is blowing on and go with that flow. When you discern the grace of God on something, you have to tap into that vein until the wind shifts. We can ride the wind of blessings. We can ride the wind of increase. We can ride the wind of change. We can even ride the wind of adversity for His glory. When you ride the wind, you are in a Holy Ghost flow, and you gain mass momentum. You're in that sweet spot where you've got crazy favor with God and man. When the Spirit wind blows, one of the symbols for the Holy Spirit is wind. John 3:8 tells us, the wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. We were born of the Spirit, but sometimes we want to live out of our heads instead of our hearts. We need to determine in our hearts that we're going to ride the wind of the Spirit no matter what our reasonings say, no matter what the naysayers say, and no matter what the devil says.
Amen.
The wind of the Spirit blew hard on the day of Pentecost, and 120 people went with that flow. Acts 2:2-4 says, suddenly a sound like a mighty rushing wind came from heaven, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. There appeared to them tongues as of fire being distributed and resting on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues. Yes, God. As the Spirit enabled them to speak. Glory. Just felt a shot of the Holy Ghost come on when I started to read that. Yeah. Sometimes we need a fresh baptism of the Spirit. Sometimes we need a fresh baptism of fire. Instead of moaning and groaning in the flesh, sometimes we need to start travailing in the Spirit for the new thing He wants to birth in our lives. See, that's where a lot of, now I just want to say this, and I love you, but that's where a lot of body, believers and Christians fail to understand is you got to have a prayer life, man.
Yeah. Yeah.
You got to pray. You got to pray. And every prayer time will be different for you.
Yeah.
You'll lay there sometimes, not say a word, just praise the Lord, or just praise the Lord and focus on the Lord. There'll be sometimes when you'll give birth. There'll be sometimes when you'll travail. There'll be sometimes when you'll laugh. There'll be sometimes when you'll cry. There'll be sometimes when you'll dance. There'll be sometimes when you'll shout. There'll be all kinds of different prayers, but you need to pray and flow with the Spirit. He'll grow, I promise. Now here's, talks about discerning wind on a thing. Before professional cyclists set out to race, they check on the wind direction and speed and wind timing. As we run our race, we need to discern the wind of the Spirit's direction, speed, and timing. But how do we discern the wind of the Spirit on a thing? The Holy Spirit, the wind of God, is the Spirit of grace. Where the Holy Ghost is blowing, there's grace on a thing, there's an anointing on a thing. One definition of grace is divine favor. The favor you have with God unlocks the favor of man. Doors open that you didn't even knock on. Grace is a Holy Ghost empowerment to do what you cannot do in your own strength. Hard things become easy. A river of provision flows. When grace is on a thing, it's got momentum behind it. When God's anointing is a thing, it's oily. When God's anointing is on a thing, it releases power. Embrace the wind of change. Of course, to cooperate with the wind, we have to discern the type of wind blowing. Sometimes the winds of refreshing are blowing. Other times it's the wind of intercession or the winds of reconciliation. In this season, the winds of change are steadily blowing.
Yes, sir.
If we don't discern the wind, we may resist God, thinking it's the devil because Holy Spirit is trying to take us to a new place. Most of us don't want to follow the comforter to that uncomfortable place of change. We want to stay in the comfort of familiarity. We have to discern the winds of change, the winds of transition.
Yeah.
Here's some Holy Spirit wisdom. You have to press into that change rather than resist it. That's the perspective you need. To everything there is a season. Embrace each season as it comes. But be ready to embrace the changes as it ends. The trouble many face in this transition from one season to the next, instead of searching for my will, they allow fear to cause a stumbling block in what should be a time of great progress and growth. Change, great change, takes place during transitions, because during these times your faith is stretched.
That's right.
Man, is that ring home? Does that have my address? Does that have everything? Square footage? Everything.
Yes, sir.
Man, that's good. Change, great change, takes place during transitions because during these times your faith is stretched.
Yeah.
You have to let go of what's comfortable before you can see the greater thing ahead. But faith is a rest. And the Comforter is there to lead you and guide you from the former glory to the next glory. Embrace the change. Look for ways to better yourself and be ready to receive the blessings I have for you in that next place.
Glory to God.
That's powerful, guys. We've been hearing a lot about the wind. We've been hearing a lot about whirlwinds. We've been hearing about whirlwinds over every state. That prophetic vision I had 2 summers ago. We've been hearing all kinds of stuff about that. The wind has blown. It's shifted us into another season. Yep. Let's embrace it. That's why you've been attacked so hard, because you've gone to another season. Yep. And the devil don't like it, because you're destroying his kingdom on this earth. He hates you. That's why he's put the screws to you as hard as he can. Because we're defeated. And he's a sore loser. He's going to get real sore, falling for eternity. Guys, embrace it. Embrace what God's doing right now in your life. Embrace what he's doing in your life. Embrace it.
Yes, thank you, Father.
Grab a hold of it and say, it's us, God. Let's go.
Yes.
Man, this has been fun, man. Yes, oh, yeah. Yeah. This is good.